What?
Just the whole progress of the situation with Iraq and the U.S. involvement. It seems real similar to the Central American, kind of the Reagan Central American connections and the atrocities that came about after. I mean, not that they had direct invasions, but the coups that were led, and some of the invasions were similar. But with regards to the distant, when the troops were gone and the government was installed, the distant support of that government that then allowed these, whether they were illegal or not, these contracts with corporations to go on. And to go on existing, and then to cause decades of oppression and murder and whatever else. How similar is the Obama administration's support now, since the troops are gone, their support of the current Iraqi? How similar is their support? Is Obama's support of the current administration in Iraq? How similar is it to that which followed Reagan's policies in the 80s? It seems very similar.
Good question. I don't want to say that Obama's policies are identical to Bush's. The Bush administration had started the war in Iraq. But actually, there was a lot of continuity. We had a lot of the same people who kept in place, and a lot of policies were the same. In the 2008 election, Barack Obama, a lot of people thought he promised to withdraw the troops. Actually, he promised to withdraw combat troops. And in 2010, he met that promise. But in order to do so, the Defense Department redefined what's a combat troop, what's a support troop. And so he left 50,000 troops behind. He withdrew 100,000, but left 50,000. And that still provided significant influence over Iraq. Driven especially by those in the Pentagon, the administration and the military, during the course of last year, they pushed really hard to extend that presence. And in the end, they had to withdraw. But the reason they had to withdraw was because the Iraqi government wouldn't sign a treaty to allow them to stay. Obama himself, I think, his instincts on Iraq would be better. One of the big problems on Iraq is that he's handed control of Iraq policy to the Vice President Biden. And Vice President Biden has consistently, since he was a senator in the Foreign Affairs Committee, he's consistently been an advocate of breaking up Iraq into ethno-sectarian regions, which to most Iraqis spells disaster, spells an escalation of violence. And I think when, as I mentioned, the ambassadors told Iraqi politicians, you can't have Shia and Sunni working together, I suspect there was Biden's hand involved in that. And certainly Biden, when they were awarding the contracts, he went over to Iraq and he lectured Iraqis on, we've got to make sure these contracts are sufficiently profitable for our guys in the oil companies. So in lots of respects, there's a continuity there. But I think at the same time, now that the troops have been withdrawn, the USA's ability to shape events in Iraq is much constrained. Until 2008, the US was the most important political actor. Now, ironically, the most important political actor is Iran. As I say, ironically, because I think the reason Iran has been so successful in Iraq is to a large extent because of US policies and the political system they created in Iraq that allowed Iran to thrive. Now, of course, there's talk of war with Iran. And I suppose, what does this say to me? Well, it says the purpose of the Iran war, it's clear from the documents, was to perpetuate the world's and America's dependence on oil. It was to open up the taps in Iraq through foreign investment and keep the oil flowing. Now, not only is that a disastrous idea for climate change, we've experienced the weather we've had over the last few weeks, but also it can't work. You know, if you try and extract ever increasing quantities of oil as they did in Iran, one of their major purposes was to keep the oil price down. How well do you think they did at that? You know, the oil price at the time of the war in March 2003 was about $23 per barrel, and then it just went up and up and up. And it went up and up and up because they tried to impose by force something on Iraqis that Iraqis didn't want. And in order to try and impose something on Iraqis, they created a political system that didn't respond to what Iraqis wanted. So when US control over that system started to decline, it was Iran that stepped into the vacuum. And so now Iran has been in power, and now they're talking about a war there instead. And so perpetuating a system of oil addiction, trying to keep ever increasing quantities flowing, means climate change. It means persistent war in the Middle East with some country or another country. And on top of that, it can't even work. I think it's time to perhaps change course. I've got David next on this one, and on there. I'll give shorter answers to the other questions.
Whatever big fancy you want. Do you think any oil corporation executives have second thoughts or regrets about not having signed contracts immediately with Bremer? I mean, obviously they wanted a stable government, but having given up on getting legal contracts and having gone ahead with illegal contracts, why not have done it several years earlier? And so what lessons are they taking away for, God forbid, the next one?
That's a good question. I think there is a difference between signing illegal contracts with Bremer and signing illegal contracts with Malachi. In that signing illegal contracts with Bremer is just so obvious and obviously illegal. The Geneva Conventions and the occupation, now I can't start signing contracts. And most people know that. And not so many people know about the provisions of Iraqi law that prohibit the executive branch on its own signing contracts. So maybe they're hoping they'll get away with it. They're also, the way they're operating in Iran now is they're trying to extract the oil as quickly as they can before the politics catches up with them. And the situation in Iran's oil industry today, I think it's rather like a gold rush. Just trying to get out as much as they possibly can, as quickly as they possibly can. And at the same time, they're also developing a plan B. You know, the oil price has gone up. And so they're now looking at unconventional oil and gas in North America and expanding there as well. I think the big oil have always been good at having a plan B. I think they're going to be, they're going to find a way of, they're going to look for a way of making huge profits, whatever the circumstances and whatever the costs, whether it's weather we're facing, or having to send troops into the Middle East to fight wars. I think the oil companies find ways of playing the situation.
Reading today about the recent violence, the Daily Farmers at local paper was saying that it was linked to Al Qaeda trying, you know, they weren't there to start, we don't know, but they were there throughout the war years. And my question is, what are your thoughts on talking with ordinary Iraqis? How did they deal with Al Qaeda in Iraq through the war years, and what would be their response if that is the case? What would the people you're talking about that are organizing, you know, at that community and local level, how are they addressing something like
Iraqis hate Al Qaeda, as you expect. Even those who have the most extreme political views, Iraqis don't believe that those views, those I think the reason Al-Qaeda has seen renewed activity in the last few weeks, and especially yesterday, is because of a sense of political stagnation. And I think over the last couple of years, you know, a lot of Iraqis, like too, are very hopeful about the 2010 elections. And this is when Iraq, points of view, will be genuinely represented, when the elections happen. And the only politicians who could succeed there were those who've been there for a number of years. I think many Iraqis, myself too, felt it's a lost opportunity. And since then, nothing has happened. The electricity situation hasn't got any better. The government is still squabbling within itself. And I think within that sense of stagnation, other groups start organizing. There's a sense of uncertainty about where things are going. And Al-Qaeda has been able to assert itself again. Sectarian identities are starting to be expressed more again because that's where the politics is heading. You know, those sectarian violence doesn't come from ordinary Iraqis themselves. It comes out of self-defense when all of the political discourse is dominated by sectarian ideas, sectarian militias associated with the political parties, and that generates a spiral of violence. And so, you know,